play with it. And I'm going to, there's things that we can do to make our code better, obviously. One of the things is, I talked about an enumeration where you would be limited. I might have added an exception for if you didn't pick high, low, or 7. I remember talking about that. I think you could all do that.
We didn't cover enumerations.
I know we did not cover enumerations. I will probably leave that to another day, and I'll simply take, and we'll make a GUI for the high-low game. But we'll use radio buttons instead. So, let me download this. And we'll start by looking at this example. Because in a high-low game, there's only three choices. There's a high, there's a low, and there's a 7. So we wouldn't necessarily want to have a freeform text field because a person could type anything they wanted to in there. All right? And we could then throw an exception if it was wrong. But it would be much better instead to limit the user interface to allow them to choose from a list of three options. And they're mutually exclusive options. So, again, I can't remember exactly what we did on Wednesday, but I imagine that between what we did on Wednesday and other sorts of examples that we did, that it wouldn't be too hard to take the code, have a text box, have a text field that you entered in a choice, run it, write an exception on the high-low game class to throw an exception, there was a problem, and display that. So I'm going to assume if we didn't do that, that that is doable. And I'm going to start with a radio button. And I have an example that I put together just for radio buttons that show you how you can use them. It's a little bit confusing, but it's not that bad. So I have a radio button, B1, B2, and B3. And when we click one of the radio buttons, notice that we have a... only one of them can stay checked. When I click run, it tells me two different ways which one got checked. So we'll look at the code that does this. All right. So, so much of object-oriented coding is, you know, what's the object? What are the properties? And getting familiar with the object and the properties is part of the job of learning Java, because you can know how to write if statements and loops and all that. A big part of writing Java is understanding the components and understanding the classes that are built into the framework. So in this case, instead of having a text box, we have a radio button. And we create the radio buttons this way. They're J radio buttons. We can create them. And we can give them text. So this one has a text of B1. This one has a text of B2. This one has a text of B3. I have my frame. I have a couple labels for results, because I'm getting the results two different ways. I'm coding two different ways, and we'll talk about the difference between the two. Notice how these are declared outside of any method. In that way, they're available anywhere throughout the class. All right. My main simply creates a new instance of this, And my new instance does all the things that we'd expect. We set the layout of the panel. We add this as the action listener. Our class implements action listener. So this class is going to have the code in it for the button, for what happens when the button gets clicked. There's only one is built into this class because I've implemented the action listener interface. And that means that because I've implemented the action interface, this class needs a action perform method. And that's what's going to handle the radio button and pull the value from it. Now, this is a little tricky. Again, I make this up, so don't blame me. But in order to connect radio buttons together, you have to put them in the same radio button group. That's what makes them work like a unit, like a radio button. Because you don't necessarily want all of your radio buttons on the form to act like a radio button. Right? You may have two groups. You may have a group for do you want to pick high, low, or 7? And you might have a group for radio button group for how much do you want to bet? $5, $10, or $15. So you might have two radio button groups. And among the option, you want those three to work as a unit. Among the bet, you want those three to work as a unit. You don't want all six of them to work as a unit together. So if I click one, it doesn't unclick all the other five. It only unclicks the two in that group. So you do that by putting the radio buttons in a button group. So the rule is only one radio button per group can be selected at a time. So if you select a new button, the old one gets unselected. So I've created my three radio button objects. I've added them to the button group. I also have to add them to the panel.
Could you add the button group to the panel?
No. Okay. All right. That's something that's a little weird, but you can. I then add my button to the panel, which is a listener of this class. I then have two labels for I'm getting the results two different ways. All right, pretty straightforward stuff to create the radio buttons. And it's pretty straightforward to use them too. I have an action performed method. One way to do this is a brute force method. I can code and I can ask if each radio button individually has been checked. So, is RB1 selected? Is selected means that it's checked. Is RB2 selected? Is RB3 selected? So if I do this way, the disadvantage is I have repeated code. This code block is the same as this code block, right? The only difference is it's looking at a different radio button. All right? So this is a brute force way. I check the radio buttons one at a time. For three radio button options, that's not that big a deal. I probably could do it. All right? If you had a situation where there were a whole bunch of radio buttons on a page, where you had a whole bunch of options, then maybe you wouldn't want to do it this way. This way is a more elegant code. Essentially, what I'm doing is I'm going to loop through all the buttons that are part of this radio button group. That's what this says. This is a different version of the for loop. So for every button that is part of the radio button group, I do this as long as there are more buttons in the radio button group. And what I do is I look at each button in turn. I look at the next button in the list. If it's selected, well, then I set the second text to equal the text that's on the button. So notice this one, I've coded the action. In this one, I've taken the text off the button. So that's why this says 1. The second radio button says R1 or R2. So when I click that, the first label gets set by this code that displays 1, 2, or 3. The second one, it displays the text that's on the button, so that's why the second one displays B1, B2, or B3. I could make this one use the text if I wanted to. This way. I could just get the text from that radio button. I don't care which method you use, either way is okay. That displays the same thing. Why would you say that the second way of coding is better than the first way of coding? Why is the better way better than the brute force way?
Anything changes, for one thing, you don't have to worry about it in the second example.
It's just automatic. Exactly. The second one example looks to see what radio buttons are there and loops through all of them. So if I added a fourth, fifth, sixth option, I wouldn't have to change the better code where I would have to change the brute force code, because the brute force code has hard-coded looking at the first one, the second one, the third one, and so on down the line. All right, let's make a user interface for our game using this. Do notice, by the way, that the radio buttons and the labels are all declared outside of the class. That means they are accessible inside of the class. All right? So I'm going to go and I'm going to save this as game GUI.java. And I'm going to create a GUI for this guy. I'm going to declare a double . Forgot to make these private, which I probably should. I will make three labels, one for any error messages I have, one for this round, and one for the balance. All right. And I'm going to create three radio buttons, high, seven, and low. I'm also going to make a text box for the bat. And I'll make a label for the bet label. The nice thing is with this, with the approach that we've taken in this class for this, I've already pretty thoroughly tested all the stuff, right? So this is just making my GUI and plugging my GUI into this. I shouldn't experience any difficulty with this. The only difficulty would be maybe I have to make sure they're talking to each other in the right way. Okay, so there's my radio buttons. There is this. I'm going to add my button group low 7 and high. I am going to add to my panel low 7 and high. I'm going to add to the this round in balance. And I'm going to comment all this stuff out, because I'm going to use it in a minute here. We compile it and see if it works. Now again, keep in mind that I don't have any of my code here, so it's not going to actually play the game, but at the very least I can make sure my GUI is the way that I want it to be. All right, I forgot something. Oh, I said private double, but I didn't finish it. Private double balance. Let's give them $100 to start. I already used the name balance. And why doesn't it know what a Java text box is? I would say there's two possibilities. One is I forgot to import it. The other is it's not called Java J text box, it's called something else, which is also a possibility. All right, cannot find symbol. JText field. Got to change this to game GUI. And I forgot to change that to game GUI. Line 35, thank you. All right, finally. There's our game GUI, and we can play. I don't think I added the label and the bet to the panel. If you noticed, bet label and bet, I did not add to the panel. So let's go and do that now. This is how I like to code, again, because I'm making sure one part of it works before I go ahead. Even though it's a small amount of code, I'm catching little dumb compile errors and things like that, and little oversights. Okay, so now I have this, that, and the other. And put the bet in and play. Nothing happens, of course. Now I'm going to add my two. I already added my two labels. Okay, so when I click, I have to decide which one they picked. So, I'm going to create a payoff variable. Double payoff. I'm going to initialize it to zero. If my first radio button, which is low, is selected, then if low is selected, I'm going to go and I'm going to say H or payoff equals H.play. Let's make sure that is the correct name of the function. Play. And I have to give the argument choice and I have to give the bet. Well, in this case, the argument choice is zero, right? Because I picked low. And the bet is going to be equals what's the name of the text field for that? BET. So we call the play game function, pass a 1, 0, 1, or 2. All right. Right, to 7. And this needs to change to high. Now notice, nowhere in here do I specify the logic that a 7 gets paid 4 to 1. That's all part of the game. That's encapsulated in the game. This code for the GUI is just calling functions on it. It has no knowledge of what the game is. It's just getting back stuff about what was played. All right. So I now have this round in balance. And I can say this round.setText payoff, and I can concatenate onto that the payoff variable. All right. Balance, I can take and say balance amount. Equals balance amount plus payoff. Notice how the balance amount was declared outside of this function, because we don't want to reset the function each time. We declare and we initialize the function as 100 up here. And I want to display the balance. Oh. These balances are all ints. So I'll make this an int. All right, we play this. I pick 7, and I bet $1. All right, I'm going to stay on 7. Yeah, there I won. At which point, I'm going to quit, because you're doomed in this game. All right? So, we got the basics of this working. But what's wrong with this issue, with this picture? I'm saying we won, but I'm not showing what the dice were. Are you going to trust a game that simply says, oh, you won, you lost? You know, I want to see what the dice are. If it's going to cheat me, at least go the full distance and show me the wrong dice. So I'm going to go. I could do this first via a string. So I could simply display, I could add to this payoff text to say what the dice were, right? There are properties in the high-low game to give me the dice value 1, dice value 2. Right? So I could say plus dice are get dice 1 value. Plus get get dice 2 value. That at least be a little bit better, right? I forgot a plus in there. Seven, and I bet one. Oh, payoff is that. 5 and 1. There we go. Finally won one. Okay. I'm also not catching any errors. So that blows up. How do I fix not catching any errors? Well, I can wrap this in a try-catch. And if I'm not mistaken, I had a error label. I need to add to this. And I can just say error set text problem. So now if I enter garbage in here, I at least get known that there's a problem. If I put in a valid value here, it still says that there's a problem now. All right. Well, I can fix that by initializing this. Every time I click the button, clear out the problem, and start anew. All right. I think on Wednesday I put in exceptions on the high-low game. If I didn't, that would be easy enough to do, right? High-no game would have to be between 0 and 2 for the option. And if I'm not given that, it should throw an exception. Now, my radio button prohibits it from getting a value of 0, 1, or 2. And what I could do is, but still, I would have the exception because someone might attach those classes to a different GUI that doesn't use a radio button and uses a text box where you entered in or something like that. So despite that, in fact, let me go and add that exception. Might as well be complete. It'll just take a minute. And I'll say this. Throws exception, and I'll say if arg choice less than 0 or arg choice greater than 2 or arg bet less than 1. And I'm not going to be very elegant with this. Throw new exception bad. Oh, in the unit test. Yeah, remember about that. That's what happens sometimes with students, is they'll make changes and they'll have like maybe an earlier version of the class in there. And they go to compile it and it gives an error. So now if I go and run this, I get that there's a problem. All right. Now, better still, so it's not ironclad, but, you know, I mean, we're catching the exceptions. We're not handling them very elegantly. Let's go and display images. Can we display images? I'll probably be able to display images, right? Let's go and look. I have, in one of my classes, I have a images for dice that I used in another project. What class was it? This is in the Android class. And what I'm looking for is drawable. I got these six dice images. I want to copy them into this folder. Okay, so D1 through D6. So I can construct the name of it, the image, right? Because it's D followed by the value of the dice plus .png. So let's do how do I add an image to a JPanel? Well, looky here. Blah, 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 blah. That looks boring. Class JImage. I'm going to start out by just displaying two dice images. Just display snake eyes to start. Dice one and dice one again. And of course, J label, a couple typos here. And I forgot to import. All right, there's my two dice. Probably should make it bigger. But they're showing one and one. All right. Now, when I play it, I need to change those two things. So let's see how I created the dice. And I'll make the screen bigger. Let's make it 600 by 600. Notice what I did. I created a label. And I gave it not a string, but a new image icon. So let's look to see how we can do that. A JLabel actually has a couple constructors, one of which accepts nothing, one accepts a string for text, and one accepts an image icon. Okay? So, I'm going to start out with nothing in there. And what I'm going to do is, if we have picked that, I'm going to say string dice one name, dice one image name, and that's going to equal D plus get value plus dot png. Then I'm going to say label dice one, or just dice one, dot set image icon to dice one image name. So I'm forming, I'm sorry, equals new image icon, and I'm going to give it the dice image name. And I'm going to do the same thing over here. Yes, I do. Now, I'm going to just verify that set image icon is a proper name. Looks like it's just set icon. So I'm dynamically going to change the icon to be this. Let's see if that works. When I first compile it, when I run it, no image at first, I pick low, bet one, play. Should have picked 7. Oh, I did pick 7. All right. Yep, I lost. Some of these things I know I went over a little bit quick. We'll revisit them next time. All right. As we go forward. Because I want to spend some time doing with this and playing with it, maybe cleaning up the GUI a little bit. Just to make it look nicer. We can talk about that. But take this code, between now and then, take this code, review it, see what questions you have with it, and I'll spend some time next time going over it in more detail, because again, I went through some of these things kind of quick in the interest of time. All right, we'll see you in lab.